Hi, Dr. Bernard here. Everything has risks. In the cases presented here, the problem would have been solved by not putting things in their body that they didn't need to put. In this particular population, depending on the personality and where they are in terms of mindset, they may not be able to fully and appropriately assess the risk, like I will show you in this video. JD is a 30-year-old man presenting to the emergency room paralyzed with heart palpitations and an upset stomach. Paramedics tell the admitting nurse that they found him in the shower with his head between his legs, water running cold. One day earlier, he had called for an ambulance. He could feel his heart racing and he could swear that he would black out only to regain consciousness confused. He would find himself periodically unable to move. He had trouble swallowing, but large contents of his stomach would empty out through his mouth. He refused to go to the hospital. JD was a bodybuilder getting ready for a show. He had one coming up in just a few days. It was time for his peak, and unless he was going to have a heart attack, he simply couldn't risk doctors pumping him full of fluids and ruining his physique. In his mind, he would know. He was confident that he knew his body well. No one else could tell him otherwise. Going to the hospital would totally destroy everything that he had been working for the last 4 months. But in this hospital today, doctors noticed that JD's heart rhythm is so erratic that his heart could stop beating at any time. They were surprised that he was even alive. A blood test finds that JD has hyperkalemia. Hyper meaning high, kali meaning potassium, or more formally kalium as shown by its symbol on the periodic table of elements, and emia meaning presence in blood. High potassium, presence in blood, but what does this mean and how did this happen? Down the hallway, a new patient was being brought in by paramedics. KC is a 29-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with muscle cramps, vomiting, and an irregular heart rhythm. A day earlier, she started feeling unwell. She had leaned out for her upcoming figure competition and was entering into the last part of her show prep. During her training cycle, she had been taking a fat burner. It wasn't a supplement that you could buy off the shelf. Actually, it wasn't something that's approved for use in humans in the United States, but that's not really what she was looking for. It put her in an anabolic state, helping her build muscle, and it raised her basal metabolic rate. Typically, she would cycle this on and off so as not to be burning the oil nonstop, but during this prep, her coach told her to stay on. Do not stop taking it at any time during this cycle, he said. Coach makes freaks, and this is what we do, she thought. But very quickly, there were many things that she couldn't do. KC had muscle cramps all the time. 1 week, her coach doubled her cardio from 45 minutes daily to 90 minutes, and she collapsed because her blood sugar was too low. In this hospital today, doctors noted that KC's heart rhythm is so erratic that her heart could stop beating at any time. They were surprised that she was even alive. A blood test finds that KC has hypokalemia, hypo meaning low, low potassium presence in blood, opposite of JD down the hall's hyperkalemia, but both of them are dehydrated. They both have very troubling muscle issues. JD was basically paralyzed. KC had horrible muscle cramps. They both have erratic heart rhythms. It's the same problems, but they have extreme opposite potassium values in their blood. Why? Less water in their body means that they had less blood volume, and so their blood pressure was low. In an attempt to remedy this, their heart started beating faster to compensate, but physically, without enough volume to push, there still isn't enough blood to make it through the body. The skin, when adequately hydrated, should rebound when stretched, but for JD and KC, their skin didn't rebound when stretched, and the blood test revealed that their kidneys were failing because there wasn't enough water flowing through them. Both were days, maybe hours out from their bodybuilding shows. This means that they were in the process of drying out and also making weight, meaning that their dehydration was done on purpose, but why would they do this? Bodybuilders need to eliminate a lot of water to get the most ripped and skin-tight appearance possible. You can't just stick a needle in them and suck out all of the water from their body. Nature tells us that in living beings, water levels are a consequence of electrolytes. Potassium is an electrolyte, but water is related to sodium, a different electrolyte, not potassium. So, how are these related? In this small science experiment, I dissolve salt in water and place it into a semi-permeable tube, meaning that only water, not salt, can flow in and out. I submerge the tube in a pool of distilled water that has no salt in it, and you'll see that water flows towards where there's salt. That water flows into the tube. Water follows where there's sodium. We've already established that there's more than one electrolyte in the body. Organs need to be able to speak with each other so they can send signals to one another to update each other on status. And they do this through chemical messengers called hormones. But this is where the problem is. Hormones naturally respond to changes in the body. Manipulating hormones makes it harder for the body to actually respond to changes. In the end, this can make permanent, irreversible changes to the body and can end with lifelong damage. And because we're dealing with organ systems, disturbing this process will impact multiple organs simultaneously. But what did they take? Let's start with JD. Anything you drink eventually gets to your kidneys, but you're not drinking the exact same amount of liquid every hour. What happens when you don't drink anything for hours? Your kidneys need a way to effectively communicate with the entire body during dehydration to save and hold onto the water already in the body. And it does this by having sensors in the kidneys' blood vessels. If the blood vessels are stretched, there's a lot of fluid flowing through, meaning that the body's well hydrated. But in dehydration, there isn't a stretch because there isn't enough liquid. When this happens, the sensors release a chemical signal called renin, telling the body that it needs to hold on to water. And this is where hormones that control electrolytes start to appear. When renin floats around in the blood, it interacts with a chemical made by the liver that's also floating around in the blood. This liver chemical gets processed once by renin and then a second time by another chemical made by the lungs, and the end result is a hormone that tells blood vessels to constrict. Because the body doesn't have enough fluid now, it needs to close these up to maintain blood pressure to make sure that enough blood gets to all the organs, especially the brain. But this hormone does more than just that. As it flows around in the blood, it goes back to the kidney. On top, there's the adrenal gland. This is where adrenaline, which is also a hormone, comes from. But when it comes to electrolyte control, the signal asks for the adrenal gland to release aldosterone, and this is the final form of the signal cascade. Do you remember that where sodium is, water will follow? Well, one of the things that kidneys manipulate to create urine is sodium. When the body's dehydrated and the kidneys want it to hold on to water, it will pull sodium out of what would have been urine. When water follows, there ends up being less urine and more body water. Aldosterone is the signal that tells the kidneys to take back that sodium. Doing this takes water away from what would have been urine so that the body holds on to water. But sodium is electrically charged. Urine isn't charged. This means that for every sodium that's taken out of the urine, another positive ion has to be put back into the urine. And the simplest one that's easily available in the body is potassium. It gets flushed out into the urine in the setting of dehydration so that sodium can come back into the body with water. This explains almost everything happening to JD, except aldosterone would cause him to have hypokalemia, low potassium presence in blood. But he has hyperkalemia. The exact opposite is happening, but this is easy to solve. Aldosterone tells the body to retain water, with potassium loss as a consequence of that retention. JD is dehydrated with high potassium, the exact opposite. And because he was prepping for a show and deliberately manipulating the mechanism of electrolytes, water, and hormones, he must have something that blocks aldosterone. This means that whatever he took is functionally a diuretic. This medicine is named spironolactone. I talk more about this ancient mechanism of electrolyte control on my in-depth second channel, Heme Review, link in the description below. Down the hallway, in the hospital, KC was struggling with an erratic heart rhythm, but she was having the opposite, hypokalemia. Knowing that she was also just about ready for a bodybuilding show, we can assume with some confidence that she also took a diuretic, but not spironolactone like JD. So, which one did she take? This brings us back to the kidneys. This complex process of refining electrolyte and acid-base balance from what ends up being urine is long and drawn out. This tells us that this mechanism is extremely important in maintaining normal homeostasis in the body. This means that there's different diuretics that work on different parts of the kidneys. Functionally, all of them will eject water out of the body, but this also means when used inappropriately, they're going to have different side effects. This explains why JD and KC are both dehydrated but have opposite potassium levels, and the diuretic that KC took was hydrochlorothiazide. It works in the same part of the kidney that aldosterone works, except instead of reabsorbing sodium to retain water in the body, hydrochlorothiazide forces sodium into the urine and it drags potassium along with it, depriving the body of both while flushing water out of the body, explaining her hypokalemia and extreme dehydration. Let's go back to the medical use of diuretics, not bodybuilding. When blood pressure is chronically high, it slowly forces changes in the body that over time increase natural wear and tear. The heart is a muscle. When blood pressure is high for years to decades, the heart is beating harder. Well, when muscles do more work over time, they get bigger. They hypertrophy. That's what bodybuilders want for their skeletal muscle. But you don't want that for cardiac muscle, because when the heart becomes too big and too thick, it can't push out enough blood with each beat. This makes it harder for oxygen to get to the organs. And even worse, you can't just stop the heart from working in an effort to get it to become smaller. Once it's grown, it's grown. It's an irreversible change for the rest of your life. Diuretics serve to reduce blood volume in an effort to control blood pressure so that the heart doesn't have to beat against as great a volume of fluid. Typically, if we need to start someone on diuretics because of their blood pressure, we start with as few medicines as possible and with the lowest possible dose. This gives us room to change the dose or add something else on later just in case we need to. In regular people, who aren't meticulously controlling everything going on in their body like bodybuilders do, daily life, when you're not this lean, can incur a fair amount of sodium and carbohydrates, both of which we already established are things that can increase blood volume, with the sugar from carbohydrates accumulating as excess adipose tissue, of which having some is natural and essential for life because it's supposed to be a storage of some energy. But diuretics aren't the only medicines that we can give to control blood pressure. Speaking of hormones, aldosterone comes from adrenal glands. Adrenaline also comes from the adrenal glands, and it increases heart rate and blood pressure almost immediately upon release. Adrenaline hormone acts directly on the heart, and we can give medicines to block it. Do you remember the fat burner that Casey was taking that her coach told her to not cycle off of? Well, that chemical is named clenbuterol, and it acts in the body like adrenaline. This means that it increases blood pressure, it increases heart rate. When the body is in fight or flight mode, nutrients and electrolytes immediately get shoved into the cells to force increased metabolism. One of these electrolytes is potassium. Because KC already had hypokalemia from her hydrochlorothiazide use, her clenbuterol use made her heart rhythm even more erratic, bringing us to the final explanation of why KC and JD are having the same problem. Do you remember that sodium and potassium trade with each other because urine shouldn't have an electrical charge? Well, muscle cells do this because the change in electricity is what signals to them to contract. Rather than filter out urine, they need to know when it's time to contract and when it's time to relax. And the most important timing involving this is heart rhythm. The muscles use potassium as a signal for relaxation. When a lot of potassium is in, the muscles relax. This is why JD came into the emergency room paralyzed. His spironolactone misuse caused potassium to accumulate in his body to the point where his heart was about to relax forever. This explains his erratic heart rhythm. On the flip side, Casey's muscles couldn't relax. She came in with nonstop muscle cramping because the muscles couldn't release. This also explains her erratic heart rhythm, just in a different way. Both of these can be instantly deadly, but it wasn't their only problem. Longer-term changes to both of their bodies were detected. Their hearts were larger than normal for someone of their age. Both their kidneys had been failing for some time because of how they kept manipulating mineralocorticoid hormones around electrolyte and water retention. Thyroid hormones were also changed in an effort to boost metabolism. Anabolic hormones were used to get the body to help recover quicker from each training session and to help build more muscle quicker. But every time any hormone is involved, you're disturbing a cascade several layers deep that's supposed to respond to changes happening in the body to maintain normal function. Once disturbed, it's often difficult and laborious to reach equilibrium again. And should it be reached, you may have incurred permanent, irreversible changes in your body. The renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system that JD changed with his spironolactone misuse, that's something that's been evolving in living beings millions of years ago. Humans have a particular form of it, but the message from nature is that you don't want to disturb this ancient system if you don't have to. And this was only one of the systems that were worked on by both of these patients. For JD, his hyperkalemia can be fixed by stopping spironolactone and removing potassium from his blood while making sure that his heart doesn't suddenly stop. Acid-based changes in his blood can help facilitate some of that potassium excess. This is the most immediate change that needs to happen to get his heart rhythm back to normal so that he doesn't experience sudden cardiac death. For KC, if her potassium is low, then it can be replenished after her diuretic and clenbuterol are stopped. Funny enough, one thing that we always try to do with patients who have problems like high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and diabetes is to get them to eat healthier and exercise, ideally before we start on any medicines. Paradoxically, bodybuilders mind the foods that they eat. They're not likely to have any of those problems of any of those patients, and they get no shortage of exercise, but they still use these patients' medicines to try to further optimize their situation. And sometimes, in the worst cases, it ends with them becoming life-threateningly ill when something goes wrong. As JD and Casey were able to get treatment in the hospital, they were able to regain some normal function again. At a minimum, they're not likely to experience sudden cardiac death, although it will take some time for their body's hormones to return to an equilibrium and back to somewhat normal function, as they were able to make a recovery. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.